So, hello everyone, and welcome to Doodle and Chill. Today, our main guest is Captain Love.
Hey everybody.
And I'm here with Nick.
Hey, what's up everybody? How you doing?
And with us, we have Ben.
Hey guys, how you doing?
And the Diaz brothers at the con right now.
Hey, what's up everybody?
Thanks for having us.
That's right. We're the only channel that's got live con action going on right now.
It's true. We're selling some prints right now.
Sweet shirt, guy. Loving it. And while we were waiting in the back room, I was starting up a little fan art for Captain Love.
Yeah, that started to look really good, man.
Now let me show it. I'm like, make sure that everybody sees it. But douche.
Captain Love is a gorgeous book, by the way.
Thank you very much, man. I appreciate that.
Definitely going to be back in that one.
Yeah. Your book's really nice, too. I already back yours, though.
Oh, well, thank you so much.
Sharing the love. So, here's your campaign, standing nicely at 59%, with 34 days to go, and only live for 11 days, 10 days.
Yeah, this is day 10, I believe, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. Doing good.
Thank you. I actually was a little disappointed at the start, because I expected some of my Facebook traffic to carry over. Mm-hmm. But Facebook severely disappointed me. I have a huge following for Captain Love on Facebook, and it did not translate.
No. It usually doesn't. We've been seeing that as of lately as a trend. People who are on Facebook, for some whatever reason, it doesn't translate over to Indiegogo. They'll transfer over to Kickstarter, but not Indiegogo for some reason.
Yeah, that's weird. It actually fine, because those Kickstarter ones suck.
I couldn't agree with you more.
Same here. That's a nice little video you got there.
Thank you.
Oh, heck yeah.
So yeah,
it's got a little disco music to it that you can't hear, but basically it's. Captain Love is a space trucker and a former war hero who is accompanied by a rogue artificial intelligence. And together they find themselves on adventures that could affect the course of the solar system. And when I say rogue AI, I mean, basically she's escaped. In this universe, the artificial intelligence are alive, like self-aware, is really frowned upon. And they usually try to destroy them. And so they were actually trying to destroy the AI that accompanies Love, but she convinced him to basically smuggle her out of the science lab where she was created. So she's basically a secret, to everybody, because the science lab probably still thinks they killed her. So.
Hell
right
yeah.
Right in time for the end of the video. Nicely done.
I've seen the video a few times.
So it's a 72 page of beautiful full color pages.
Right, yeah,
there. That's a big book.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean for the amount of money that you're charging for the book, it is a lot of book for money. This is one of those very good value for money books that everybody really, really likes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm hoping that that the price point is going to be a enough to where people really want to just buy it, even if they don't know me well enough or whatever. I mean, this book is done. It's not like they have to wait for it to get finished. I mean, it's ready to go to print. It's ready. It's going to be printed perfect bound on 85-pound stock paper and 14-point cover stock. So it's going to be a really nice quality book. We get to the 10K funding level, I'm going to actually do red and gold foil where the title is on both the original cover and the variant cover. So
that's cool.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
And this is a mature team comic.
Yeah, it's mature. It is. It has nipplage and breastises and sex and violence and all that good stuff.
Yep, that good old stuff from heavy metal.
Yes, very very influenced by heavy metal. If you love Heavy Metal Magazine and the writing and style of that book, you're gonna absolutely adore Captain Love. It's completely based on that vein.
So I think Ben, we're gonna have to do a crossover, all three of us soon.
I'm down. Yeah,
that sounds fun.
That would be interesting. We'll talk about that.
The artist, good.
Thank you. Yeah, the artist is named Andrea Bormita. He's in Italy. I was really lucky to come across him. I consider myself blessed. He's mad skills.
It gives it like an old classic comic sci-fi style, like we were discussing before, like pulp fiction.
Yeah.
Pulp sci fiction. I like it.
Yeah. Yeah, he kind of developed because this is not like his other styles. He kind of developed a look just for this book, just for these, just for these characters.
Yeah, it's very Buscema type.
I don't know who that is.
John Buscema was one of the Marvel artists back then. He was the one that did the How to Draw Comics the Marvel way.
Oh, okay.
With all Stanley.
Right. Yeah. I like the fact that. I'm sorry.
Did he do both covers or?
He did both covers.
Excellent. Okay.
I was just saying that I like the fact that the story seems to be very character driven, which I find I don't see too much of that in sci-fi, and that I really like that.
Yeah, I thank you. I appreciate that. The reason why I think that it all turned out more rich than obviously it's going to be more rich than Marvel or DC because they're weak as shit these days. But because it started out as actually the concept was actually part of was a movie. The whole Captain Love thing started out as a short film, got extended into a full length film. We're making storyboards, and then the guy that was doing the illustration for the storyboards, suggested that I tell the backstory to Captain Love, how he became the hero of the cleansing, and the story about why he's believed, to have a legend that can live that he can live forever. All that stuff isn't explained in the movie. It's just like his mysterious past, this book explains all of that. So I actually had to come up with a storyline to hit all of those points. And so some of it's told, like the whole Hero of the Cleansing part's all told in a flashback. The part where he meets Spade and all that is basically, the main storyline. And then he tells Spade later, towards the end of the book, the third part of the story is how he got the legend of, where he supposedly can live forever.
Awesome.
Yeah. Awesome. So I'm excited about the book. I've put everything into it. I mean, not just all of myself, but like all of my savings and the next
book. I feel that.
Fantastic so far. So I'm actually working on the next book already. The first chapter of the next book, which is called Rise of the Pirate King, is already finished. The first chapter is illustrated and with the colorist now. I've got the first 8 pages back from the colorist already. And it's going to be just as awesome as this book, except that it's not going to be a backstory. It's going to be actual adventures.
Yeah, so. Oh, that's cool. Okay.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
The book is fully completed already. So as soon as you're done, it's going to printing.
Yeah. Well, actually, I'm probably going to send it to print as soon as I have a good idea of how many copies I'm going to need, because I want to expedite the shipping on the ones that are ordered through this campaign. So it's going to cost me a little bit more on shipping to do that, but that way I make sure that I got enough books for everybody in time for Christmas.
Good stuff.
Christmas.
Yeah, this I intend to have this delivered to people in time for Christmas this year.
So this could be a Christmas gift. That's sweet.
Yeah, my perks is based on that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
So let's go over those tiers for fun. The first one, you said the perk was $20.
Yeah, the first one's just the book. It's the original cover. It's not signed, but it's $20, and the shipping is included in the price. So there's no shipping on top of this.
No shipping. Yeah. That's good. And it's included. What, yeah, but that yeah. Can, do you do international? No?
I do international, and I will discount. I'll discount the amount that that I dedicated to shipping United States off of the international. So if it was, let's say $10 is the shipping for one book or whatever, then it's taking $10 off of what I would the international shipping. So that much of the domestic shipping price is built into this tier.
Good. Cool. Awesome.
And it's actually like that for the first five tiers. All of the first five are like that.
So. And this is one cover, then that's the variant cover.
Yeah, and then so you can get either the original or the variant, same price. Neither of those are signed. You want a signed book, you go to the next one down.
Boom.
If you want those signed, just hit me up. I mean, if you're finding me on a stream or whatever, and you can't, you forget to buy the sign add-on or whatever, and you want to have it signed, just contact me, DM me, let me know so I can get your book signed for you. So.
It's just there to be official if you want to give a little bit more as a tip type of thing.
Right. Yeah, I mean, really, I'm all about being flexible. You know what I mean? It's like if there's a tier here that you want something that's not like offered in a package, hit me up. I'll make a package just for you and give you a one count on it and make it a secret perk. You know what I mean? I'm not difficult to work with here. I want to move these books. So.
So this is the two pack for both covers.
Right. Basically, both covers together. $30. There's no shipping on that.
Those same thing applies for the signing. For
$35. The same thing, and same thing for this too. The shipping's built into this price.
Then you have the $40 one, which is the book and all nine trading cards.
Right, now this one does have shipping. Okay, but the idea behind this perk is that the trading cards themselves will standard be coming in three packs, randomized. Right. So to get all nine cards any other way other than this campaign, you would have to buy a bunch of packs until you got all nine. You know what I mean? And then you'd have a lot of extras to trade, et cetera, like how trading cards work. So so if you want to have all nine cards, you got to buy it through this campaign because they'll never be offered again outside of this campaign altogether.
Then you have the one book and T-shirt for $45.
Yes.
All you need is love.
Yes, all you need is love, and yeah, that design for the T-shirt is shown better towards the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
And then, there
you go.
Yeah, that's it right there. All you need is love. And then there's a one of everything perk
for $60. $60,
and of course there's shipping on that. But then this gives you two books, a T-shirt, and a three pack of cards.
Then you have the couples pack.
Yeah, and that's both covers and two T-shirts so that, the couple can share. You can have, however your couple works. I mean, if you're a man and a woman, you can have a male and female T-shirt. If you're two men, you can have two male T-shirts. If you're two women, two female T-shirts, whatever floats your boat. Yeah.
Then you have the collector's pack for $100. What's
right. Now this actually is a original cover signed, a variant cover. A three pack, the whole nine pack of cards, because it's a collector's pack, and there's a T-shirt in this, which I don't have included here. I need to actually swap this one out with another one that has the T-shirt included in it. And obviously, I want to put two original covers in the picture because I've had some confusion about this one. People keep asking me, and I've had to make some because they doesn't say this. I've actually made a couple of secret. Actually, one for this package, I had to make a secret tier. To get it to sell it to somebody who wanted that perk, but they didn't say T-shirt on it, so they were like, oh well, will you make me one that has a T-shirt on it? And so I made a one-off secret perk for him.
You could copy it and just put replace that one by it. You made that one.
Yeah, exactly. I just got to redo the picture too because I want to put two of the original covers because one's signed. You actually get three books, a T-shirt, and all nine cards in that perk. So
awesome. And for the Santa's pack.
Yeah, the Santa's pack, that is three of the original cover, three T-shirts, and three of the three pack of cards.
You have the Mother's Load.
And the Mother's Load, Santa perk on, you know, steroids. It has five of the original cover, five of the variant cover, two t-shirts, and five of the three packs of cards. This is designed for, you know, people who want to buy Christmas presents in bulk.
Mm-hmm. Or a little LCS.
Right. Well, the next one's actually designed for the LCSs. This one is actually designed for your LCS because I basically took their pricing model and knocked it down an additional 33%. I mean, one third, you know, so that they could actually make a decent profit still selling at the same price point that I'm selling at.
Oh, wow.
And this is the nuclear option.
Right. Now, the nuclear option is very special. This one, it does not have any shipping, if you know, and it's United States only. But, and there's no shipping on this. It's built into the pricing. And there's 25 original covers and 25 variant covers in this nuclear option. So you get 50 books for $500, and there's no shipping on that. So it's basically, you know, a deal and a half. And if you buy this perk and you're like a hoarder or a collector and you actually look at that kind of value, mm-hmm. I mean, if this campaign gets past the 10K mark, you know what I mean? That means you're going to have the foil stamped books, you know, in horde mode, which means that as Captain Love gets more popular and, you know, more, you know, books get made and that kind of stuff, this campaign and these books that you get from this campaign will have dramatically higher value than any other book after this. So of this story.
And here's a nice little sample of all the nine trading cards.
Yeah. Yeah, those are the nine trading cards.
So this is...
So the first one, the first card there is Jean. That's Captain Love's best friend. She's also fought along his side in the cleansing. And then obviously next to her is Captain Love. And then next to him is the Hauler, which is basically his semi, you know what I mean, as the space trucker. That one there in the red, that's the Queen of Venus. In the absolute middle, that's Spade, the artificial intelligence. And then next to that, that is the voodoo princess Odessa, is the one that cursed Love to live forever. Mm. And then Millie, who doesn't appear actually in the book, she's actually in the splash page at the after the book. She's almost like a post-credit scene. Mm-hmm. but she's Barney's girlfriend, and Barney is the opposite corner of her in the green jumpsuit, the green coveralls there. And then in the middle, on the bottom, that's the executive general.
And that's the big baddie.
Yeah, that's the bad guy. The douchebag.
He looks like one too. I think he captured his douchiness very well because he just looks like he looks like somebody you want to punch in the face repeatedly.
Yeah, he has a punchable face.
Yeah, I mean that's kind of one of the hallmarks of good bad guys. You just want to come up and punch him in the face, kind of like clowns, you know.
I'm glad that we achieved that because there's a scene that in the book where he's like really laying the douchebag on thick, and I don't know if I can share my screen with you. Can I do that?
So yeah.
Okay. Show you.
I'm locking on you right now.
All right. How do I share the screen on Google?
You go in a little 3 points on the top. On top of the Google Hangout, there's 3 points.
Okay, yeah. And then I go
share screen. Share.
Sweet. Yep. And then I select application window, kapow, excellent, share. All right, so I'm going to show you that scene that I'm talking about where he's like super douche. Okay, so boom. I'm ready when you are.
It's done.
Oh, is it?
Okay. Yep.
All right. So right now you see they're fighting and they get captured by the corporate soldiers, and then the executive general walks in, and then they kind of describe him a little bit. That's the scene you see there, and this is they're talking about how he killed all the other executives who opposed him, and then he pulls his douche mode here where he's kind of like, what do we have here? And he holds her face. He's pretty, very nice. Licks her face. You know, yeah. Like fear, slaps her, calls her a teasing trollop. And, you know, you guys got the douchebag mode there. You see what I'm saying?
Like, yep.
Yeah.
Old douchebag.
He reminds me of like a mix of Lex Luthor and like what the evil Captain Picard would be like.
Oh, okay. I see that.
Yeah, because like, he's dressed to the nines. He's all, I mean, it's very militaristic, but he is dressed to the nines and everything like that. So, but you can see, like, he's obviously a psychopath because he killed everybody that stood against him.
Right.
But he also, you know, he's got that captain-esque, he's got that prowess about him as he walks through that door that he just blew a hole through and stuff right. like that. And then comes up and starts, you know, pretty and all, you know, just being a complete and total douche. And, you know, the Trollope thing is a nice little ad. I mean, he's got that Picard-esque style and mannerism to him.
Yeah, he really has like royal airs at that point of power achievement. You know what I mean? He's just basically like all powerful because the corporation is like a conglomerate of all the brands, and he more or less took over the corporation because anybody who disagreed with him is dead. So,
well, that's awful. That's nice of him.
Yeah. Right.
I was gonna say that you reminded me of a mix of Lex Luthor and remember that guy from Stormwatch, that guy that was always in the tower.
I don't think I ever watched that or saw that.
No, he was like, yeah, he was in charge of a satellite with a bald with the little headband that was controlling everything. Ended up being a bad guy.
Mm.
Cold, calculated guy.
I'm trying to think. Yeah.
I've never, that must, it was that, was that a comic book or a TV show?
It was Stormwatch. It was by, created by Jim Lee back in the early years of Image.
Ah, okay. I must have missed out on that one.
Yeah, they had like one of the heroes for each country.
It was one of okay. I remember that. Okay, and I know what you're talking about, but I don't ever think I got into it.
All right, now this helps Spade a little bit. If you can see my screen on this one, this helps explain Spade a little bit. If you see here, she's kind of, I don't know if you can see.
We're lost on you.
Yeah. All right. Over here, you can see she's like overlaid in front of Love's view. So like he actually captures her. I mean, she actually gets into his optical implant that he has. So so she's actually like able to project herself inside his eye. So, you know, she like has an overlay when he's like doing stuff. So she goes with him everywhere. And so as you can see, this is the view he has where she's like overlaid in front of his view, you know, and then she can get afraid, angry, sad, happy. She has emotions. And so she's, you know, a living artificial intelligence that basically she more or less hijacked him. If you look here in a scene a little bit earlier, I don't mind sharing this because this is, you know, part of, you know, it's like you already know this is going to happen. But so like he finds her in this room and she's trapped behind this this green you know, stasis field, and she basically asks him to turn it off. You know, she just says, over there in this control panel, hit these numbers in. He punches the numbers in and instantly she's all like, oh, that's better, thank you so much, can we leave? He's all like, where are you? And then boom, she's in his head. You know, she's there. She is now hijacked him.
I like how when you when she shows her emotions and everything, she has a color to it. That right. is a very, actually that's something that a lot of people would leave out. They would just leave that background and the stuff around it, just like the normal color or whatever. And I think that gives it a nice little nice pop to it, and it also really conveys the fact that she's angry because since she's an AI and everything like that, emotions showing on a face that's a digitally done face might be a little bit hard for people to recognize, but you can definitely tell once you get used to the colors what the emotion is, and I think that makes that character a little bit more real, and it gives it a, you know, especially since she's basically in his head. That right. That really gives it a good way of delineating and showing what emotions are there.
Yeah. Now she doesn't just exist in his head. Now her SPADE stands for Synchronous Protocol Artificial Intelligence Delegate, and what that means is that she can basically hack any computer through an open network and claim it. And then once she claims a computer, you know, you have to actually erase that computer to get rid of her. So she can exist in several computers at once, and as soon as the networks connect, it becomes like one single entity. You know what I mean? And
she's Skynet.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So she's Skynet, more or less. You know what I mean? But like, so like here in this, you can see she's actually in like Love's hauler. She took over his hauler as well. So she's able to like exist both in his computer that exists and operates his optical implant as well as the hauler. So, you know, she can bounce between monitors, you know, whatever she wants to do. I mean, she's basically all powerful, you know.
That's cool.
She's like a big virus, yeah.
Yeah. She really, really is. I mean, and if she was, if she had ambition, you know, or some kind of hateful, disastrous approach, she could really do some damage.
Oh Lord, yeah. I didn't think about that.
Because,
You know, if all she's got to do is just go by an open port and she's, you know, Bob's your uncle, she's got it.
Right.
I'm sensing a future storyline here.
Oh, there's a lot of future storylines. I mean, in Rise of the Pirate King, I don't want to go into too much of the next book because that's you know, it's a long time before you guys will actually get access to it. But in the Rise of the Pirate King, there's going to be an introduction of another artificial intelligence, a more immature one that's just like a baby who's just like starting to learn. It's not as advanced as Spade, so it'll never get as advanced as Spade. But it's one that was hijacked and basically from another location, and they're trying to use it to populate an army of robots.
Oh wow,
wonderful.
So imagine an army of robots with an AI as powerful as Spade. You're talking, you know, I mean, this one won't be as powerful as Spade, but I mean, it's supposed to make you think, you know, what would happen if Spade took over an army of robots, and what would, you know what I mean? It's just, it's like, you always wonder like what kind of disaster it could be, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. It's like, you know, making the, second most powerful being in a certain universe, a whiny, cry a teenager that just lost his girlfriend and both his legs and an arm.
Or remember in the Resident Evil movie, where was it, a little girl, that AI?
Oh, yeah, that was creepy. Or like in Bioshock with those little girls that roll around with the big monsters with the six eyes and stuff.
Big brother and the little sister.
That game, I played it for a little while and I had to stop because I started having dreams about it and I was like, nope, we're done.
Yeah, when a video game intrudes your nightmares, then maybe it's time to stop.
Oh, I dreamed in Warcraft for a year, so it's like you get used to it, but I just didn't want the Bioshock thing in my dreams.
Oh yeah.
So. We're still standing at 59%, so go get that book.
Yeah, everybody, back the book. I need this book backed. I want to have this thing in as many people's hands as possible. I don't, you know, I'm not counting on getting my money back from my investment. I just want to move books, you know? So, I just want to move books.
So no matter what, the book gets printed, even if it doesn't reach its flexible goal, it's getting printed, you get your book.
Right. Yeah, it'll just be, you know, there'll just be less that I expedite shipping. I mean, I chose a modest number because I didn't want to go 500 or 1,000, you know what I mean, because I didn't want it to look bad. I feel as though 1,500 is reachable. I hope that we can get way beyond it. I will hope we can get to like 15,000. We get to 15,000, Vinny's going to draw a pinup, extremely sexy pinup. Like, I'm going to push him on his sexy limits. the Queen of Venus, and Hexbox is going to be the one of a slave girl that hangs with the Queen of Venus is going to be modeled after Hexbox. So.
Come on, 15K. Yeah. And we need to say a little special. She's had a bad day. Her grandmother had to go to the hospital. Yeah. So keep her in your thoughts and prayers. And also, Terry. His mom had to go back in the hospital this afternoon, so let's keep him and his family in our thoughts and prayers as well.
Yeah, we're with you.
And also, well, actually, you know, my mom's about to have another surgery on her back. This will be the second one, so, you know, rough times ahead.
Good thoughts for your mom too, man. Jeez.
So we send you all guys some love.
Yeah, it seems to be that kind of day.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, let's see. We're switching over to Outlaw Knights. That's fine.
No. Go. What do you want to say? I was going to say, okay. Anything else you want to say before we move on?
Well, I was going to say, scroll down so we can get a good look at the variant cover for everybody.
Have the first cover here.
Yeah, that's the first cover.
And the variant cover is right here.
This is the variant. Both of these were drawn by Andrea Barmita, which is my illustrator.
Yeah, you can see the switching in the styles between the two covers. I mean, this one is very... the first cover is got a more of a... I almost want to say it's a more of a European feel to it, but this second cover has definitely got a more of a... I'd say early 90s Marvel DC look to it, maybe a little bit.
Yeah, he really wanted them to feel different from each other. He made a point of saying, you know, it's like, if I'm going to do a variant, it's going to feel completely different. And I'm like, I told him, I said, you know what? Do whatever you think works. Whatever you do, that's what we're going with. So.
Hell yeah.
And see. Boom. Shared the link in the other group. So, Captain Love, moving to Outlaw Knights, now at 20%.
Yep.
So, little pitch.
Alrighty. Well, Outlaw Knights takes place about 1,000 years from now. It's a time period in which humanity has begun colonizing outer space. It's still very much a new frontier time period. Oh, yeah, and check it out. We just put on the lettered pages of these pages. Just to give you all a taste of my style of writing. In the midst of all this, we are now 5 years in the wake of the end of World War III, and the space race is still very much going on, and tensions are very high. And in the midst of all this is Cyrus Lawson. And Cyrus, our main character, who's got a very heroic way about him, but at the same time, he's had a very traumatic past, and he's just ready to have his own quiet little spot. But unfortunately, that's not going to happen for him. Pretty much right at the start of the book. the pirate crew of Hazard has their sights set on a special piece of data that is located in an art gala that's happening in Therese, the colony where Cyrus lives and Cyrus is a security guard for. Cyrus responds to this threat along with his fellow team. I can't give away what happens, blah, blah, blah. He gets kidnapped. And so he now has to figure out how to survive amongst a bunch of pirates. He also has a very, he has a pretty strong prejudice against criminality. But he's going to have to figure out a way to get past that if he wants to live. So essentially, this is hopefully going to be the first of 6 issues. And I'd like to keep it going beyond 6 issues, to be perfectly honest. But it all just depends on reception, really. But and this is essentially Cyrus's start into breaking into the world of pirates and piracy. And as you can all can see, our artist and render contender and our colorist, Pressy Colors, have done incredible jobs. I'm blown away every time I look at them. And I just, you know, when I was first just putting this project together, when I met these guys, it was like everything just fell into place. And I truly believe this is going to be a gorgeous, gorgeous book. It's not complete yet. That's part of the high number here on our goal. And I know that, yes, our release date is around December 2020, but I put that there mainly just to give us a little bit of room in case there's any hiccups or what have you that might happen. My ultimate hope is to be able to release this earlier than December 2020, but I'm just keeping it, you know, I'm playing it safe, you know. Yeah, it's going to be fun. I've put, you know, 10 years I've had a lot of these characters in my head, and it's fun to be able to flesh them out on the page. So yeah.
And having them coming to life.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so, let's talk about that for a second real quick. Y'all have all, I know Sam, you with Vincent, you with Outlaw Knights, and also with Captain Love. These are all passion projects, and it's something that you guys have been trying to get done and get out for years. Does that make it easier or harder?
What do you mean, make it easier or harder, that it's been for years?
Well, no. Does it make it easier on you to let me see how I can put this. Like, I know that with some of the creators out there and stuff like that, they just get the books out and it's gone. You know what I'm saying? But like the three of y'all, these seem to be like passion projects and stuff like this, and stuff that you've been working on and working on and working on. Now that it's finally here, with it being that kind of passion project when you were working on them and getting everything put together and stuff like that, did that make it harder because you're trying to make everything perfect, or did it make it easier because you already had it so set up in your head and everything like that, that it was just like boom, 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 boom?
I would say that that sometimes there were easier elements and sometimes it was harder. Like, you know, like having the idea preset in my head locked down on some things ended up being a negative to me, because I'd be working with the illustrator and he'd have something different in his head, and then we would butt heads. And then I'd end up having to, like, you know, like think about it a long time, because, you know, we'd argue about it and he ended up being right. You know what I mean? So, you know, that whole adaption thing is, you know.
I mean, I find that I kind of agree with Drew. Like, it was like certain elements were easier in that, like, number one, I feel like I'm not super strong when it comes to like selling. But I can really sell this because I don't feel like I have to bullshit people. You know what I mean? Because I really do care about this and I'm determined to get it done. But also, and I found that like it worked in that I was able to put a great deal of detail in my script. But at the same time, there were certain elements or certain things that like I just wasn't super strong with in my writing. And so like those were actually elements that Render was strong with. Like Render came up with all these layouts for these settings and stuff like that. Like when I wrote like my scene descriptions, I gave people an idea of kind of where people were and like kind of the setting of like the lighting and all, but I didn't give like all this detail as to what's in the room. And like I remember Render, that was something that he had been wanting to do for a project. He wanted to do some sci-fi like layouts and backgrounds. So it was like we complemented each other when we did this. And it's awesome seeing how like it's become, I feel like it's kind of become bigger than what I was imagining. And so I think that's very good.
Okay, cool.
Me on my side, I'd have to say that I think it's a bit harder, but it's the same thing. But me, it's a bit harder on the fact that I wanted to start with the Natverse first. We've talked about this before, Nick. Wanted to start bringing Nat the Merc and building the Natverse. But since it's something I've been working on since 2010, and I published the first story here in 2012, it's something that I'm very much invested in, and I've worked a long time. So it's kind of like, it's more of a long shot of like, please, people like it. It's like the weight of it is bigger compared to Blood Hunt, where, you know, I've been working on it, like setting it up for 2 years, but I've been working on it for a year, and it's not as much, I'm not as emotionally and everything invested as creating an entire world, making it work. You're trying to make it perfect. You know, it's like when they say start with a short story instead of a big epic, right? You get invested in it and you want it to be perfect and you start weaving everything. And then when you let it out, you're like, hope everything works after all these years.
Yeah, it does get scary. You know what I mean? Like there's a part of me that knows that I did Captain Love the best that I could, that the story is really thorough and complete, and there's no like holes in it. I mean, I even added pages to make sure there were no holes in it, and you know, and it's like a, it's really a standalone, you know, thing, as well as the backstory, as the introduction. And hopefully it's going to be something that everybody loves, but you can't make anybody love anything. You know what I mean? It's like, mm-hmm. so like the acceptance of Captain Love, you know, between now and Captain Love being like fully accepted, that's like a scary time, yeah. You know?
But I would add, like, you know, it's also the fact of like, when it's a long invested project, you're like, you're not thinking about the criticism because you've worked on it a long time. You're not like thinking like, I didn't do it right. I made a mistake. You just want people to actually like it. Well,
right.
When you're doing something that not as long, you're like, hopefully people will like it, but you're also like waiting for the criticism because it's not, you didn't work as long on it to develop everything. So, you know, it's.
Well, I'll tell you, like, I think I'm more in that boat a little bit just because, like, I've had this idea in my mind, but it was, like, it took me a long time to really, like, get down and do a complete story for it. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And it was really writing it as a comic that helped bring that together for me, especially since I felt like I had to kind of, in order to, for the change in the medium, I had to kind of simplify certain things down, which was kind of a challenge, but it was a fun challenge.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, simplification was something that I had to like learn working with my illustrator, because like at first, I was giving him way too much, you know, information, and I was putting too much forethought into certain things that I needed to give him the room to do his thing on, you know?
And so I
learned that, okay, what we need to do here is we just need to describe the stuff that is essential to telling the story moving forward. And so basically, you know, I make sure he understands what elements are in the story that can't be changed. And then I have to learn to accept everything else as the way he'll address it. And then I got to make sure he's consistent. Like, no, you can't do it like that because you did it like this over here. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
That makes sense. Sorry to interrupt. That question popped in my head and I've been wanting to ask it for a little while. So I'm sorry if I interrupted a flow or anything.
Oh, no, I was pretty much good with my pitch for the most part. I thought we were going to start going into the tiers and all, or the perks.
Go ahead, Nick.
Well, we got our first perk up here, which is, of course, you're going to receive an issue of Outlaw Knights as well as the digital preview. And you are also going to be drawn into the book. And as you can see, it would be you would look very sexy being drawn into this book. I wish I could be drawn into the book, but...
You're not?
No. Well, I mean, if you think about it, Serpent kind of looks a little similar to me, but he's way more handsome than I am.
Well, hopefully. I mean, if I was getting drawn in the book, hopefully it'd make me more handsome. Jeez.
So for $25, you get the book?
Yep. It's the signed standard issue. Wait, what?
Signed or unsigned?
I'm not going to be signing any. I'm going to ask Render what he thinks about that. I just think that my signature is not really worth much right now.
I mean, maybe not, but if the book picks up, then yours does too.
Yeah. Yeah.
So $30, you get the book plus the digital.
Yep. That's the digital preview. It basically, the way it's going to work is when we've got the first 20 pages finished up, we're going to compile them and send them out. So essentially, about, I would say, midway through production, you're going to get half of the book right off the bat digitally.
Hmm. For $45, you get the digital print.
Yep, and we do that.
Yeah.
And yeah, we get the digital plus the print file. I mean, what am I saying? Yeah, I said that right. Yeah. Sorry.
For $50, you get two physical copies.
Yes. That is correct.
75, yeah. You get 4 physical copies plus digital. Is that still the preview? Or that's a digital copy of the book. Digital
that preview. Is both.
Oh,
there this you go. Is actually probably the best deal we've got right here.
So then that should be your
my yeah. featured.
Yeah.
Why that? I was trying to switch it out. I couldn't figure it out.
You just go to your perk and you go in the select tier on top when you go there. And you just
click. Oh, I did that.
Yeah, and you can select the tier you want.
Oh, I know, but I thought yeah, I was trying to switch my featured perk out with another one, but for whatever reason, it wouldn't give me the option. And
that's weird.
I was looking all over for it.
So you have the comic plus the artwork. How does that work?
Well, Render Contender is normally a digital artist, but he has volunteered to do 10 pages by hand. So if you sign up for this perk, you will get Outlaw Knights Issue 1, the digital preview, and you will also get a page of original artwork. And the way that's going to work essentially is it's going to kind of be the first one to back is going to have their pick of the litter, and it's going to go down in that succession.
Good. So go back that book because it needs to get funded.
Yes, indeed.
So next we have Magic Pop by the Diaz brothers. I was gonna say Magic Pop because I saw the pop that they had, like that little box thing.
I was looking to see the progress on that little
blockhead. Hey.
Yeah. So we just got the file last night for this guy. So we went over to the print shop. This is actually bigger than we doubled the size of it because we work for a printing company at our arcade. And so this guy's bigger than you'll actually get it. But everybody that backs the book is going to get either the sheets that they could cut up to make this guy, or if they back the digital tier, they're going to get the digital file so they can print it out and make a little Magic Pop block.
That's awesome. No, I like that. Looking out for the digital buyers like that to make sure that they get that is a very, very nice thing.
Yeah, we were like, oh, we have the PDF, so we could just send it in the digital version of the book.
It's super easy to put together.
Yeah, we put it together pretty quick last night, really easy. It's awesome that he made the wand, too, with a little magic coming off. The guy does great work. I implore anyone that has a campaign to hit him up, see if he has time to throw together a little character, because it's just something extra for the backers at this point. You know?
So, I just want it for me now.
So which one are you guys at now?
We're at this little pop-up convention. It's called the Horror House. It has a lot of Halloween artists, like horror artists. Some people selling old like VHSs of horror movies and stuff. It's really chill. A lot of cool creators from the Chicago area, Indiana area, around here. Some guys selling comics and stuff. So we thought, Magic Cop would be a perfect book for it because we're all Halloween based. In the book, and Brandon does a lot of like holiday pinups. So he did like a Scarecrow and Creature from the Black Lagoon this year.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah,
nice.
Yeah. So those are his newest ones. So they've been selling pretty well, and yeah.
I really like the Creature from the Black Lagoon there. That was cool.
Thanks. Yeah, he's really proud of those ones.
Nice job,
yeah,
Brandon.
So that's what we're doing here.
Thanks.
So,
and then also, he printed actually the pilot issue. This is our first printing of Magic Cop. It'll be, I guess it would go down as the first appearance of Magic Cop in any comic book.
Nice.
So it has the 12-page pilot issue, which if you guys go on to zadecomics.com and sign up for our mailing list, you'll be able to read that there. But since then, I've re-lettered it since I've become a better letterer, and we actually have it in print form. And this will be the version that's also in our ash can. So when you guys back the featured perk, which is our book, the 88-page book and the ash can, this will be in that ash can among a bunch of other concepts, background information about making the book, stuff like that. So that's
that looks great.
Yeah.
Thanks, man. Yeah, the colors just pop off the page. I love what Eugene did with the colors. It's just like this little trailer scene of them going after this guy who's a kabuki demon. He's like a general, like a shogun general who's running drugs in the city. And he's got a bunch of demon henchmen, is one of them. So his name's Daimyo Kuei, based off of the Chinese god of ghosts, Zhang Kuei.
Japanese?
No, it's Chinese. I don't know. One of those cultures. But yeah, and then on the back, if you flip it over, is another four-page story for my upcoming comic book that's going to come out next year called The Lost Pages. And this is one of the characters in there named Wildcard.
Yeah.
This was a comic that I wrote with an artist, Maxi Gallo, who does the art for Jack Iron's Steel Cowboy. This is all traditional art. So we're selling that over here.
And you're going to have one of those Lost Pages short story. The silhouette is going to be in CG Jumpstart, right?
That's right, yeah. We have him kind of, if you can see in the background of this page, the cover to that story is kind of faded in the background. The silhouette is another one of my big characters from the Lost Pages. So check him out in CG Jumpstart when that comes out.
Yep. And it looks freaking cool. Awesome. I've seen some pages.
Thanks, man.
So how's the con going?
It's going well. Today's been a lot more people than yesterday. You know, they did like pre-sale tickets and stuff, so they sold like 80 tickets for Saturday, which is awesome. Been meeting a lot of new people.
So go back, Magic Cop.
Magic Cop.
We have one week left. It closes next Saturday. And we're trying to get to 100 backers. So we have 82 right now, I believe. And when we get to 100, we're going to add another stretch goal. So when we get to 100, we're adding some cool stuff. We're thinking about throwing in a postcard for the city of Ambrosia. So you guys will have a cool landscape, or we're going to hit up one of the people that did fan art for us to see if we could turn one of those pieces into a postcard that everyone's going to get. And then, of course, our next stretch goal is going to give you guys some awesome bookmarks that highlight every character. Brandon's almost done with those bookmarks, so we'll post some pictures up this week.
Sweet. So go back that project right now.
I already backed it.
So, thank you. So look at, you want to give us just a quick little pitch for it?
Sure.
Before I go back to drawing.
Yeah, so Magic Cop is our 1980s Blast from the Past retro comic prime fantasy, mixing the styles of Miami Vice with Halloween Town, monsters, and magic. The first story, which is on Indiegogo right now, follows Iggy Cromwell, who's a new Magic Cop. He has his magic wand passed down from generation to generation. So it's a title that he gets. He's right off of the graduation stage and thrust into being a detective. His first case is the investigation into the murder of a mermaid hooker. He has to work with his new partner, who's a wolf man on the verge of retirement. He's tired of being a detective, and they have to help each other out to solve this crime. He on the team also is a sexy, flirty witch and a giant leprechaun, and together they find out there's many more skeletons in the closet of the city. Fast cars, hot beach babes, and even hotter crime. The only detective with the spells to stop it is Magic Cop. So back to get today, everybody.
Yeah, and the tiers are quite simple too. You get the feature tier for $45. You get the signed book plus the behind the scene book. You have the digital Magic Cop for $25. The signed book for $25. Two signed book for $45. The signed book plus the naughty prints. So the naughty prints for $45. What are the naughty prints?
Yeah, we actually have a good show on the naughty prints off right now. So Brandon does the interior covers of the book also. We have some awesome cover artists on the book. Pablo Romero did the main cover. Elliot Fernandez did the Ashcan cover. And then it's a four-chapter book, so there's four interior covers. This is the first cover, and as you can see, there's no knife here on the campaign page. There's a big knife in front of her, but she's topless on this one. So this will be the print that you get, one of them, for the four naughty prints. Indiegogo is great. They have an add-on section. So if you guys want to get the featured book, you know, featured tier that comes with both of the books, you can go into the add-on section. You can pick up this print. You can pick up all four prints for a discounted rate, or any other, you know, covers and prints that we offer for the book in that add-on section.
Yeah, awesome. So go get those naughty prints.
Yeah. Joe Frog was excited about that one.
I think everybody is. Where was I? There you go. Comic plus Ashcan. So you get four prints of each. Is that it?
Yes.
Four prints. Okay, sorry.
Yeah. That one, we're actually going to contact people, see if they want the naughty versions of them or the censored versions.
Here's the five comic bundle. What's that here? You get a mat for a...
Yeah, so that's the retailer one. Comes with five comics and a exclusive retailer poster for their shop.
It looks like a yoga mat. It comes with a yoga mat.
If people want it, hit us up.
And you have the Elliot Fernandez cover for $700. You get the original.
Yeah.
Plus the
You get the original Pennsylvania inked cover. Comes on 11x17 Bristol board in a protective sheath. And also you get both of the books, the graphic novel and Ashcan.
Sweet. So go get your magic on now.
Yeah.
And before I close this, go check out Blood Hunt. The most badass assassin vampire in comics. He's not a vampire hunter. He's just an assassin. So,
but he's also a vampire.
Yes.
So awesome, guys. Well, we're gonna have to go because our data is running low. Mm-hmm. But thank you so much for having us on.
It's a pleasure.
Yeah, no problem. Thanks for stopping by. I appreciate it.
Yeah, it was super fun. Okay, have a great rest of the show. Have a great weekend, guys. I'll talk to you later.
Have a great one.
See you, Philip.
Later.
So, go back. All these nice little projects. I'm keeping that one open for my little fan art switching window. So, any other mentions that you would like to do? Like, I would like to mention The Gods Fear Me by Mike.
Murphy?
Yeah, Murphy. Thank you. By Mike Murphy. Let's call him Papa Smurf. You need some love too. Any mentions that you guys would like to do?
SOS just dropped yesterday. It's already halfway funded. And that's by Chimera Comics, and it's drawn by Evi Canales. There's two books in that campaign. There's another one in there called The Argonaut. They just added the tier for that book. It's a 22 page cyberpunk that's looks really, really good as well. It's not drawn by Evi Canales. It's drawn by I can't remember what the artist's name was, but it's really, you can get both of them, and there's variant cover as well that's by somebody's name who I'm not going to try to pronounce because I will destroy it. And but it's all everything in there is in their entire campaign is extremely, extremely good value for money. Even with shipping, it's like the book was like, I think shipping on it's like $4 or $5 for, and it kind of goes up in increments, but you can also get drawn into the book for $100, I think it is, $100 or $150, and there are only two spaces left. So go check that one out. It's called SOS Volume 1. It's on Indiegogo.
And you, Star, any mentions you want to do?
I mean, other than the normals, like the Grim Reaper team and Cybershock.
Yep.
Yeah.
Check those projects too. And you, Ben?
Outlaw Knights looks really good on Indiegogo.
Okay, the Case of Lilith's Umbrella is one.
Before it
closes.
Yeah, I would like to make sure that people who are thinking about it's Halloween time. Vinny has that kids book, that Halloween book. That's true. I've already looked had it in my hands. I've already read through it. It is a good little book. It is definitely worth the investment.
What's the name of it again?
It is The Ghostly Manor on Howling Hill.
Yep, go back, Vinny. There's also Azmat with the Road Warrior Duck.
Oh, shoot. I knew I was forgetting him.
And there's a little bit of time left to go get a copy of Vestige still.
Yep, that's also true. From the lovely guys on our campaign.
Antonio's book, Brand, that one by Antonio.
Mm-hmm.
That one is also looks like a really good book to get.
Brand is still alive?
Yes.
Yep.
Damn.
I backed it earlier this week. They're getting down to the last pages being, Cap's done with all the drawing and everything. It's just doing the coloring and stuff now, I do believe.
Awesome. No, I backed, that was one of the first books I backed.
Good. Yeah, them and he's doing a crossover cover for Grom right now. The Ikari Press crossovers. There's two tiers in the Grom campaign where it's the book, but it's a Cap White cover, and it's got both of the characters from Brand facing off against the characters from Grom.
Huh.
And it looks really good.
Yeah. I have a I don't know if you guys know Preston. He has the Doc Salem book. Also another one that would be kind of cool for people going back is Doc Salem. He wanted to do a crossover cover with Captain Love. Not cover, actually it's gonna be a pinup or a poster for Captain Love, and we were kicking around ideas with it. I told him that I like the idea of Doc Salem and Captain Love kicking it in a strip bar.
That would be funny, yeah. And that's Preston Acevedo, not Preston Puller.
That's correct.
That is a very important distinction that must be made on that one. That is, but yeah, I've got that in my push list of books that I'm pushing is Doc Salem. It looks really good. And for those of y'all who don't know who he is, his Twitter handle is Nikki the Pipe. He did that outstanding variant cover on the Gods Fear Me.
Yeah, he's got some skills.
Yeah, he does.
And his story is kind of interesting. The way he has, it's almost like he took Dr. Frankenstein and turned him into Van Helsing almost, but a monster hunter. You know what I mean? So it's really interesting the spin he's put on these these classic characters.
Yep, definitely. I've been watching that book and everything like that, watching it go through. It's a it's an interesting looking book, I will say that. And man, he's a fantastic artist. I'm glad that he's starting to get some run and some play in some things.
Yeah, I would like to see his book do really well. I mean, he's a really nice guy, so, I want to see everybody's book do. We should all be, clearing, $75,000, but we're not. But I wish we all were.
One day.
I wish.
We would sell more if we could, find a nice way of dealing with the shipping for international. Because that's one of the things that's killing everybody.
Yeah.
Because it limits our reach,
Yeah, I got international figured out. I went through USPS and got all their shipping rates. You know what I mean? It's not cheap to ship internationally, but it's still viable. I mean, like if you were going to buy something from the UK and have it shipped here, it's about the same.
Yeah. I just mean, like, you know, you do have people that are limited to the amount of books they come back at in a certain time because of that stuff. That's what I meant.
Yeah. And, like, different, I know, like, we're similar in Canada. He can take advantage of the Commonwealth shipping, which would be great for him shipping to 24 other countries, but not to the United States. So it's like, yeah, and it's weird. It's like we're right here at each other, but he can ship it for cheaper to the UK or to a bunch of countries in Africa or to Asia cheaper than he can ship it to the United States.
Yep.
And that's but he also gets to take advantage of the Commonwealth thing, which we do not. It would be nice if there were a way to everybody to take advantage of that.
Mm-hmm. I'm looking into the people that I'm going to use to do my printing, Print Ninja. They do advertise that they will, because it comes from, you know, overseas anyway. They do advertise that they will allow me to ship to a European based location for redistribution. It costs more, you know what I mean, than they're even more than their expedited shipping, but it would be cheaper than shipping it back to the United States and then shipping it out again. So.
Yeah.
But instead of Print Ninja, did they ever check like the Canadian printing where Marvel and Image print their comics?
I actually don't know. I have searched everything I could find online. You know what I mean? And some people have introduced a few other things. But for the numbers that I want to ship, I mean, I want to do at least 1,000 books minimum.
Mm-hmm. So, that's what I'm telling you. It's called Quebecois and Transcontinental. I'll give it to you. They're the one that, yeah.
I'll check it out, man. Send me the info. I'll definitely dig into that.
Mm-hmm.
Send me the info too. Yeah.
No. Will do. Because, you know, when you deal in that type of amount, they will offer you a good deal for the shipping if you're just shipping in one spot.
Yeah. Okay. That's. I definitely, if I can save money and still get the quality that I, you know what I mean. I'm into it. That's essential. Good quality is essential.
There you go. Indeed. Studying the face. Give him a nice little.
I like
Captain America type of style smile.
Yeah. Don't forget that Captain Love has long hair though.
Yeah.
It's like one of those like few little key points that I'm anal about.
Yeah, he has his hair all going slick in the back with the.
There's a reason why I'm a little anal about that.
I know why.
I was not predicting that.
Also, just to kind of throw it out there, because I don't know when he plans on launching his campaign. Be sure to sign up for the mailing list for the second book of Guardians of Orloff.
It's already launched.
Has it already? Jesus,
yep.
I'm behind.
Yeah, it's already launched, and he's about, I think he is, let me check real quick. Chael Ehyun, it's at 47% funded already. Oh, it's got 48 days left.
Good, I need to go and grab it because that first book was amazing.
Oh, God, right? It was so good. I made the mistake of underestimating him, and I would never ever do that again, ever. It blew me away how good that book was, and it's not just the story and the art and the color and everything; it's the quality of the book. I mean, I did a 4-page review on it, and all I did was try to tear the pages of the book and like get ink to rub off on my fingers and stuff, and it wouldn't do it.
Wow.
It's fantastic quality. I'm telling you, everybody should go out. If you missed the first issue, there's a tier in there called the Lyser Berserker tier, and you can get the first issue, which has a Cain and White cover, and the second issue, which also has a Cain and White cover. And so you can get all called up. And it's definitely, definitely worth it. It's one of the biggest surprises that I've had so far in Comicsgate. But yeah, his campaign is live on Indiegogo, and go check it out.
Yeah, and don't forget our buddy Passions, the Doom Fate that just launched like 2 days ago.
Yeah, that looks good. Yeah, and he launched that day before yesterday, I do believe.
Yeah. And last time I looked, he was at 25%, I think. And that book looks awesome.
He is almost at 30%. He's at 29% right now.
Even better.
Mm-hmm. There's so many good books right now. You know what I mean? It's like, I don't understand how people can afford it. I can barely afford to, you know.
Dude, you're just preaching to the choir. I'm getting poor. It's I spent, let's see here, in the month of October so far, I've spent almost $250. That's in 2 weeks on comics. And I'm that's a lot in 2 weeks for me as far as comics go.
Yeah, I'm up to like I'm up to like around, you know, around somewhere between, considering I just backed a couple more yesterday, I really don't want to know what the actual number is. But since August, I've backed 29 books.
Good Lord.
Damn.
And where are you, Star?
Started blowing us all out of the water.
Yeah.
I hit 74 yesterday.
I remember last time I'm like, dude, you had 60. He goes, no, I'm not. Oh, fuck, you're right, I am.
Yeah. I hit 74 yesterday.
Yeah.
You're a champion, sir.
74 is insane. That's a lot. I mean, hopefully that's built over a long period of time.
Yeah, I've been doing this since April, May? Around there,
I've been doing it since February, and I've only got 43. I gotta catch up.
Don't get that mentality. It will burn your wallet to the ground.
Well, my thing is like I'm a notorious multiple backer on projects, so it's like, you'll get more than one back from me 9 times out of 10. So
I really know.
Yeah, it's like that. But I'm starting to run into the issue that there are more books out there than I have money. So we're going to have to talk before. I'm going to have to change my spending practices, I do believe.
Well, I gotta change my spending practices a little bit. Even though I want to back everybody, I got to like really slow my roll. Because, I mean, like I said, I back more books right now than I have in backers. So, I mean, even just on my campaign, I'm upside down. Like,
yeah.
Well, really, the most important thing is to just back Captain Love, back Outlaw Knights, back Blood Hunt, and you'll be good. You know.
That's right. Everything's covered there.
For sure, because you will not be sorry with the Captain Love backing. Because I'm going to make that book that you're going to get in your hot little hands as valuable as I possibly can. So.
Yeah. I mean, my book's action-packed from page one to the last one. So I'm not bullshitting when I'm saying one of the most action-packed comics in CG.
Hell yeah!
You can ask my editor.
I keep the action going. I keep the action going. It pretty, you know, it rarely stops in my book.
Well, I have to say mine's not my every page of mine is not action-packed. I mean, sometimes I have to connect the action scenes with dialogue. So.
Yeah, well, yeah, I mean...
Dialogue?
It's not a giant fight sequence, but, you know...
Dialogue? What the fuck?
Dialogues? What the hell are you talking about? This is a comic. This is a visual medium. Come on, let's show your chops. Show it, don't say it.
Somebody should do that. They should write a book for CG where it's like it's just a big action sequence, like one action sequence that's like 48 pages.
How would you do that?
But you know, that's one of the plans that I had with Blood Hunt. Like the end was 10 pages and I wanted it to be like 20 pages fight, a 20 page fight at the end.
There you go.
I mean, I could see where you could have a book that was all action if you didn't have to establish characters too much, you know what I mean? Because it would be hard to be established characters and have, you know, I mean, and still have a lot of action going on around them, you know. Unless it was like in flashbacks, but then you're doing flashbacks, you'd lose the action. So.
Yeah, but the aspect of, you know, a character, if it's built in within the character.
Yeah.
Like, mine's an assassin, so it's pretty much like, you kill.
Yeah. Well, I'm looking forward to reading yours. Yours looks freaking wild as hell, dude. So, I'm looking forward to it.
I aim to not disappoint.
Good, because I hate being disappointed.
Let me look. I'll show you something right now. Do I have quick access to it? Hold on a sec. Let me go get it. Poof.
Oh, he's gone. Okay.
No, I'm not gone. I'm looking for something. right here. First, doof. Get to the file.
Hey, Jason, did you back Necromancer?
Of course.
Have you gotten your books yet?
Not yet.
Okay, never mind.
I see everybody getting theirs, and I'm like checking my mail every day.
You are going to be very, very happy when it happens. The covers on them are fantastic, and they're like very thick cardstock and stuff like that. And the pages, this company that they fulfilled through did very well in the fulfillment, because they come in Gemini mailers, and then they're inside of a plastic folder that has a sealed they're sealed inside of something. So I got two out, and then my other two are still, they're out of the Gemini mailer, but they're still in the plastic the heavy plastic
bag of cardboard.
Yep. Well, it's not cardboard. It's just a plastic mailer, because the Gemini mailers themselves are like a three-layer fold out of a cardboard thing where you just slide it in and
I was checking those out. Yeah,
they're pretty indestructible. But yeah, the fulfilling company that they used is really good. So you're gonna really like it.
Well, Nick, if you're interested in taking a trip to Tennessee, the company I work for happens to sell display pedestals with glass cases.
Hey, I need a spin one. I need a spin rack.
I could, I'm not going to make any promises, but I could probably get you one.
Word. Yeah, you don't live that far from me, so we might have to do that. Yeah, plus, I want to come see it.
You're south or north?
I'm in Asheville area.
Okay. Because I have family that lives near Columbus? No.
That's Columbus, North Carolina?
South. They live in South Carolina.
Okay.
Yeah. So I go there quite often, so.
Well, we will work something out.
Yes, most definitely.
No selling family members now.
No, but yeah. We're one big family.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, we are.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah. What do you think about the Captain Love?
I think it's turning out awesome, man.
The category.
Say hey to the chat real quick. We got Chimera from Chimera Comics in the chat. We got Aaron Calamari. Hello. Aaron's got Cyber Shock out, so go back that. Chimera's got SOS. We got Hexbox in the chat. Hey, Hex, how you doing? We got Liam Gray, Anime Hitman. How you doing?
Yo.
Liam said that when EVS's stream ends, he will pop in. So that's cool. Chimera's got he's got the SOS comic book that I talked about earlier, with Eli Canales as the artist. So go check that out. And Aaron, of course, has Cyber Shock. There's, I can't believe no one has scooped up that name, the Tank Perk, yet.
I know, right?
I thought that would have been gone by now too.
At $40 and you get your little shot at immortality, you know what I'm saying? Because like you get on the credit page with Hex, and they're going to say the tank's name at least once in the book, and they are it's going to be on the tech spec of the tank itself. So definitely, if you want to be in a book like that, go check it out. And it's cheap. That is one of the cheapest ways I've ever seen to get in a book, period.
Grim Reaper has a really good way too. They if you back any of their tiers, they put your name on a tombstone. So basically, so that's pretty cool.
Damn. Yep, I backed them. I backed them last week, I think.
Yeah, and I know from firsthand experience because I'm always buying up tiers where you get put into the book. So
I know that Outlaw Knights still has about 10 spots for you to get in the book, drawn all sexy by Render Contender.
Is that drawn all sexy by Render Contender?
I really should have called it that. I was trying to make my perk names as like easy to understand as imaginable, you know.
Yeah. And that makes sense though.
There you go. Xbox was like, "Where am I, Sim?" There she is.
Don't let her ego, please.
Nah, she's had a rough couple of days. We could pump her ego up a little bit. We just can't make it a habit because she will run forever with it.
So that's Hex next to Captain Love right there.
Yeah.
With the hand near the crotch.
Hey, she said she wanted to be in it.
Let's see. What was it, Drew? She saw your campaign once on one stream and then convinced you to put her in a poster?
You know, what happened was Vinny and I were talking about like possibly him doing a pinup of the Queen of Venus, and and Hex is she's really good at getting attention, and she's going to help us push the book heavy. So we were talking about what we might do with that, and she's all like, I want to be a slave girl. So we just decided then that because Hex is going to be pushing hard, We'll just and it's its own selling point. So basically, the Queen of Venus, which is a character in the book already, has slave girls. So basically, Hex will be one of the slave girls will be modeled after Hex.
Hell yeah!
Mm-hmm. That's awesome. Yep. And that happens at 15K.
Yeah, at 15K, and everybody gets a copy. I'm going to even if you already have the books or already shipped out, I will reship the poster. You know what I mean? So that at 15K, everybody gets one. So
yeah, I'm waiting for a free check to use to buy Captain Love for sure already. But
we actually recently got done with a secret tier where 7 backers are getting limited edition posters of the cover. And those are actually going to be mailing out on Tuesday.
Yeah, that was a very good secret perk. I'm glad that those got taken up very fast and quickly, because that's a steal of a deal on that perk, getting a poster from Render like that.
Yep.
So that was cool. I do want to mention one thing. Eudaimonia has just put a tier in there in his book or in his campaign, where he's taken that beautiful color cover that he has, and he's made it into an 11x17 print poster.
Hell
and
yeah.
There are 25 of them, and that's it. And they're already printed and ready to go. I've seen them. They are at his house sitting. So
sweet.
Go and check that out, by the way.
I had a secret perk on my pre-launch for that was exclusive for the people that signed up on the mailing list, and nobody took it. It was the book and an exclusive poster that's not part of the campaign, and nobody took it. And I let it expire after a week. So it's like I'm thinking about maybe like putting it out again or something, because I'm wondering what I would think that would have. I mean, because it was basically the book at the regular discounted option that we have. At the price that we have here, but then a poster that's exclusive included. Mm-hmm. What I mean? I also had another perk that discounted the book by a few more bucks too, and nobody went for it. I don't understand that at all. So, I mean, it's a buy. It's like, why wouldn't you go for it?
I think if you probably relaunch it,
like resend the email out again to see what happens.
Yeah, I would do that.
I don't want to edit any updates, because then the people who've already got perks, would see it. Have to be the original list again, but
yeah, definitely do not update the list. If somebody's not on it, then that's their loss, not yours. And that's and you shouldn't the other people out there who signed up or something like that, they shouldn't have to pay that price either.
I was surprised that I didn't sell any vampires, but the two werewolves sold out. Be a werewolf in the book, yeah.
Are you a werewolf? Love werewolves.
Do you like make them change into werewolves in the book?
Yep. They'll change it. They have a full page where they're going to be morphing into a werewolf. Yeah.
That's awesome.
And is John Malin one of them?
No, Star is one, and Chris Evans is the other one.
Okay.
The vampire one didn't sell. I don't know why. You're gonna fight Vincent in the end, but nobody took that one. It's still there.
Maybe it was just like, you know, too many flashbacks to the Twilight thing, you know.
Then what do you think I'm doing this? No,
we're
seriously.
To chill that myth.
Yeah, exactly. It's like fuck that. No, they screwed up vampires. Let's bring them back. That's why, like, in one of the joke and one of the scene, he makes that joke that they made in one of the anime where they're like, "What the fuck are you?" He goes, "I'm a real fucking vampire." That's what I am.
Hey, Liam Gray says in the chat, Ethan said, "Get in contact with him, and he will help get your money from Indiegogo."
Seriously?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what he said in chat.
Awesome. Thank you.
Cool.
Hello. Way to go, being the hero, Liam Gray.
Good stuff. So yeah, that's ridiculous that it's still going on.
It's been 2 months. Yeah. It's. I just say it slowed the production a bit, but I'm still working on it. Like.
But yeah, they're screwing you over.
Mm-hmm. Are you still planning on getting that American account set up?
Yep. I have an appointment for the 23rd, but I talked with Rowan. He advised me to. One of the problems that could be is like they're trying to deposit like as if I was a you know in the States having an American account through my Canadian account. That's what I just found out 2 days ago. But it's something I've been telling them. I think you're not using my IBAN and my SWIFT, and they're like, "No, we stopped using that now." And I'm like, "God." So now I'm gonna try and open an like American account with CIBC. Like one account here and one account located in the States, so I can deal with them. Because this is ridiculous. It's been 2 months. Like, my campaign ended in the 18th. But, you know.
Yeah. That's crazy. Yeah, I would be hella irritated, man. It's good that you can even, like, maintain composure. I would be killing people.
It's taking a lot.
Well, Indiegogo definitely needs to work better on their customer support and the network that they have getting a hold of customers that are having issues.
And you know,
their sales people are really good, though, man. They have all kinds of helpful information. They were telling me all kinds of ways that I could spend money to draw attention to their stuff. Not necessarily through them, but they were telling me about like all these different people that you pay $5 and they'll like you know, like introduce your shit to their audience and all this other stuff. They recommend you know that you know you do. I don't know how well it works, but you know they definitely. Are all about you know trying to be helpful. So.
Mm-hmm. You know, I've been drowning it in work. Nick and Star can tell you I've been working pretty much day and night and just doing books.
Mm-hmm. I mean,
go ahead, Nick.
No, go ahead, dude.
I was just gonna say, speaking of work, we also have new shows coming up to look forward to.
Mm-hmm.
Tuesday. Yep. 6 p.m. Well, MS26 and 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Myself and Adam AF from Arch City Comics will be hosting a new show called CG Ignition. And we're starting with Gat and Steve to wrap up Vestige and start talking about CG Jumpstart. Episodes after that week, we will have on the writers and artists and the people that have projects within CG Jumpstart. To get a first look at the stuff going into it.
Sweet.
Here's a little sample of Crash Course.
Yeah.
Not showing more.
And then, of course,
Do I show the Demon and G-String page?
Yeah, you can show the first page. Demon and G-String.
There you go.
Yeah.
Oh, I've seen this one.
I swear he looks like McTheridan just without the pot belly and the tail.
I dig that. Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, you're fine.
This is the exclusive poster that was in the in the perk.
Oh, damn. Yeah, that'll sell.
I'd buy it.
That's good. That's about the same thing as I did.
Yeah, very similar. I what you're doing. That's that, but you know, but it's not the same. It's different. Different. I like what you're doing too. So don't stop.
Okay, I scrap everything. I'm restarting. Bye bye.
I like how you gave him that kind of wise ass smirk. Yeah. I like that.
That's what he's giving me, like, as an impression that you even have, like, a little, like,
That's essentially kind of the vibe I wanted to give off with Ivory, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Just that kind of, he's that wise-ass, smart aleck, and he's always got something up his sleeve.
I thought he would be a bit cocky. Am I right?
Oh, yeah.
Captain Love is seriously cocky. He's like, but he just doesn't give a shit because he's been through so much. He's seen everything, so you know, and like his heart belongs to the voodoo princess who cursed him.
Mm-hmm.
So just like rest of the girls that fucking like just basically treat him like a fuckboy. You know what I mean? Because he doesn't really give a shit about them, but you know he likes to get his dick wet. So.
There you go.
Yeah. So you also have your star. You're also bringing back the critic, obviously paid critic, one of Nick's favorites.
Totally paid critic.
Totally paid critic. Sorry.
But yes, it has been a long time coming. Yes. I've kind of been waiting for things to die down. That's been going on Twitter, and just kind of take a break from streaming for a little bit, but. I was thinking about it last week, and I'm like, you know what? It's time for people to loosen up. It's time for us to get back in the saddle and bring back probably one of the most entertaining shows I put on in my
life. I love that show. I want to be on it as often as possible.
And I will definitely keep that in mind, Nick, for sure. For people who haven't seen it, Totally Paid Critics is a show where myself and Sim host a panel of three guests. We have three campaigns that have already been reached their funded goal, and all the guests know of the campaigns beforehand, but they don't know which campaign they're going to get when they go on the show. During the show, we go one by one, each person getting their campaign, and they have to perform a pitch as if it was their own campaign. Then the remaining two guests both give a positive review and then give a totally over-dramatized SJW negative review. Get as funny as possible.
Oh, that sounds fun.
I want to do that.
And I have to say that last time, the first show we did, Nick was the only one that made me mute myself. He made me crack so freaking much when he came in as the SJW. Dude, it's like, imagine Nick came in like Nick. It went like I muted myself because I couldn't stop laughing. Even the kids looked at me like, "What the hell's going on?" Don't. Yes. And he was ripping my mind to shred, and I couldn't freaking hold it.
That's great, though, man. That's great.
That was fun.
And just so everyone is aware that is watching the stream now or on the replay, this Thursday, the comics we will be talking about will be Cyberfrog, Graveyard Shift, and Jawbreakers.
Oh wow.
That'll be a fun show.
You're just not messing around on this one. That's good.
And so far the confirmed guests are the returning champion, Red Gaze.
Oh.
And Cyborg. Those two have both confirmed. I'm still waiting to hear back from Moss, but hopefully he does get back with me.
He'll be good on that. He'll be good for that.
Yeah, he'd be awesome. That would be
what time is that at?
Oh, it'll be on Thursday at 6 p.m. Eastern Standard Time.
Wait. Yeah, everybody needs to check that show out because it is absolutely hilarious. It's one of the best times I've ever had on YouTube, and that's saying a lot. But everybody should check out that show. And definitely tune in on Tuesday for the CG Ignition. I think that's going to be an interesting show as well.
And me, I'll give people a heads up that me and Cider Hype, we've been planning on putting a new show together that's going to be like a CG American Gladiator type of show, pitching creator artists versus each other and having a guest host every day, every time. It's going to be fun.
Oh, hell yeah.
You say pitching artists against each other, you mean like their drawings, or are you going to like
their drawings, in... they're drawing like a chat, like
those little things they beat the shit out of each other with?
Yeah. It's going to be like, you know, you're coming in as a character, like you're a gladiator, right? So you're coming in and you're going to have the host that's going to animate it, like, you know, those shows. Here's the, you know, Passion, the Exterminator, versus Vic, the Eviscerator, and Simon, the, you know. And the thing is, we trash talk, we have fun all along, right? It's all in good fun, but you have one subject, one challenge, and one object, you know, you have to put in there.
So it's what Drawn and Quartered used to be and should have been.
hyped up. And, you know, you have to be that type of announcer, you know, like... to pitch people against each other and going, look, that's John Malin, join the foot that's gonna kick everybody's asses, type of thing.
Sunday.
And you know, we're gonna have a bunch of guest artists and one rotating guest host, but you know, it's everybody's gonna be role playing. That's the idea. We're going there to role play and have fun, you know, take puns at each other and just in good old fun. What happens there stays there. It's an arena,
like the Colosseum. I would be honored to be a guest on any of these shows.
well, Simon, you have to pitch.
I think I would rather just sit back and crack and laugh.
What, Star?
Well, Simon, you'll have to pitch the idea to Cider, to where one of y'all to start the timer or whatever for the battle to begin. You'll have to say, let's get ready to doodle.
Yeah.
Get ready to doodle! Yeah, that's gonna be fine.
I'm sure he's gonna be on with it.
But actually, I think later on tonight, actually around 9:45 Eastern, Red and Lola are starting a new show, and Outlaw Knights is gonna be on it today.
Yeah, Red's doing like some kind of marathon tonight that's gonna have like a dozen people waiting to be.
Yep.
Like, smoke books tonight. It's gonna be crazy. It's gonna be Merry Boys and Vinny's gonna be there, and it's gonna be a lot of books.
Yep.
Now, what time does that start?
9:45 Eastern.
Yeah.
And that's on Red's channel, right?
Yep.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
That is true.
Mm.
And tomorrow at 2 p.m. if no one out there is busy, please join me for episode number 4 of Sunday Conversations. I will be joined by Rob Carey of Cyborg USA. And I think JP is going to be on there as well from Eudaimonia. We're going to be going through their books real quick. And then the show is just sitting around having a conversation, talking inside baseball, giving ideas and stuff to new creators about how to, you know, the writing process or finding an artist or something like that, and just going through their experiences and talking about stuff.
Hell yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Sounds good, man.
So yeah, we're reaching the over almost 2 hours now.
Wow.
So let's do the log out for everybody. So let's start with Mr. Love.
All right, well, Captain Love, please back Captain Love on Indiegogo. We have extremely good price point tiers, awesome opportunities. Captain Love is a space trekker and former war hero with his rogue AI who lives in his head, basically his walking conscience. He has virtually no control over, and they get themselves into little situations that will change the course of the solar system. And in this book itself, you get to figure out how Love met Spade. You get to figure out how he got the name, the Hero of the Cleansing, and you get to learn about his legend, which basically is a rumor that he cannot die.
Hmm. So go back, Captain Love.
Yes, please go back, Captain Love. I've put everything into this. It would please me if you all had a book. Everybody. Everybody on Earth needs a book.
Oh, I concur.
And you, Ben.
Yes, sir. Outlaw Nights is going to be live on Indiegogo for another 41 days. We are 20% funded. Really exciting stuff, but I'd like to ascend beyond Super Saiyan now. So everybody get to Indiegogo, share it with your friends and family who are over the age of 17. Essentially, Outlaw Knights, we are going to be following Cyrus Lawson as he is kidnapped by pirates and forced to learn to adapt and survive among them. And we will see his descent into the world of criminality in the future. So back Outlaw Knights today.
Indeed. And we have our host, Star.
I'm Jason Star from the StarCast Network. It's been fun. Sorry that I dropped in a little late. But yeah, go check out these projects. I guarantee you won't be disappointed.
And the master promoter and host of CG of the Doodle and Chill.
Hi, everybody. Tinfoil Hat Nick here. You can follow me on Twitter at Tinfoil Hat Nick. Also on YouTube at the same name at it's just Tinfoil Hat Nick. If you like the content on there, make sure you hit the subscribe button and turn notifications on. On there, I do 4-page reviews of Comicscape books. My next review is supposed to be Battle Maiden Knuckle Bomb, but I might be switching it up to do Necromancer because I just can't wait to do it. Also, you can find me at 10 a.m. every Saturday on Arch City Comics and here at 6 p.m. Just about every Saturday on Doodle and Chill. And then Tuesday or Sundays at 2 p.m. on Sunday Conversations. Go and back all of these projects that you've seen here and that we've talked about. At the end of the day, they can make these books all day long, but without you, the backers, none of this means anything and it's not going anywhere. So please go out and back these books and make this stuff happen. These are great books. And with Christmas coming up, I can't stress this enough. If you have comic book fans in your family or in your life that is a friend or a family member or anything like that, and you don't know what to get them for Christmas and they love comic books, buy them comic books from CG, from these creators. Go for it. They'll love it and they'll thank you for it. Y'all have a good night.
And I'm Sim. This was Doodle and Chill. Go check out Blood Hunt and have a good night.
Good night, everybody.
Night, everybody. Thank you.
And thank you for coming, people in the chat. Hail.